And hello, everyone. So today I want to talk a bit about research staff networks and how we can how we can work with Vitae and related organizations with regards to career development. And most of my conversation is going to be with from my own experience. So I'm a researcher like many of you, and I'm in a lab most of the time. I'm a scientist. And I'm going to talk mostly about the experience I've had with the College of Life Sciences Postdoc Association at the University of Dundee. So that's going to be a very unique perspective. I recognize that a lot of institutions, in particular PADI, for instance, at the University of Edinburgh, they have a very different setup for their institution. So take everything I say with that in mind. So to give you a sense of what I'm going to talk about today, I want to review some of the benefits of research staff associations. I'm just curious, how many people are involved in a research staff association of some sort, a postdoc association or something like that? So a few of you. I also want to discuss some of the existing associations, and I'm going to miss some, so please let me know if I've missed the one at the institution where you work. And I want to discuss one method for improving how the workings of research staff associations. So there's one particular issue that I'll address. And then I'll end with some problems that research staff face and how we can approach those problems in light of the Concordat and career development. So very briefly, why do we need to have an organization? Why do we need to have a collective voice for research staff? And this is probably not necessary for me to answer if you're here, but just for the sake of review, we come from different disciplines. Everyone in this room has some degree of variation in what they do, and we also come from different institutions. You know, we all have similar aspirations, namely want to be some sort of research manager, whether it's a principal investigator or something along those lines. And the problem that we face is that, well, for instance, this document, What Do Researchers Do, that Tenny worked on and with Vitae, is puts forward the percentage of people that go on to do various tasks following their PhD. So in my own field in biological sciences, 60% of people following their PhD go on to do research. And in my particular discipline, biophysics, that number goes to 70%. Granted, most of those individuals are going on to do a postdoc effectively. But you can assume that that means that they're all interested in becoming research managers. The problem that we face is that I think the number is something around 10 or less percent of the individuals that want to go into an academic research position. Only 10% of the individuals who want to go will find a position that's open to them. So we need training for other things. We need the opportunities to develop transferable skills to do other things. And so that's in part where having a collective voice is, because in having a collective voice, we can find out what sorts of training we want to receive, and then take that to organizations like Vitae or to our local Roberts Agenda-funded career development staff. So to give you a sense of how I'm accustomed to viewing these things, the research staff association that I work with, effectively our mission boils down to three things: support, representation, and networking. And support basically falls into two categories. One is career development, and the other is essentially inductions. So when someone comes, like myself, when someone comes from overseas or is new to an institution, how can you help them get acclimated and settled at the institution, make sure they know where everything is, who to talk to if they have a problem, et cetera. Representation is effectively, the research staff association serves as a conduit between the research staff and the managers and administration as well at the institution. So you have up and down conversation and communication, and I'll talk a little bit about that in a few moments. And networking is in part social activities, but many times researchers, in particular in my experience in a lab, we tend to be with blinders on and focus very much on our work, and maybe this is true in other disciplines, I don't know. But networking is to get people to engage with one another, to get them out of their offices, out of their laboratories, and in doing so, you also start to get people engaging with their career development and thinking about their careers, which Sarah had mentioned before. So my own experience at the University of Dundee, just to give you a sense of how things are structured, the University of Dundee has four colleges, and two of those colleges have research staff associations. We also have very close ties to some of the professional training groups that are associated with the university. So Generic Skills Dundee is the Roberts Agenda-funded careers transferable skills training program at the university. Revealing Research is a public engagement and outreach organization for the entire northeast of Scotland. And Genetic Skills, Revealing Research, and Bio Dundee, which is a business development program in the city, all put on workshops, training workshops to give people the opportunity to develop skills outside of the laboratory in our case. So having research staff associations with our collective voice, we can take and communicate directly to these different training organizations or groups what sorts of training we want to have, what sorts of things we're interested in. And actually, I, as the chair of the Postdoc Association in the College of Life Sciences, meet with the directors of Generic Skills and Revealing Research on a regular basis to talk about issues of interest and also to propose ideas for training that they might provide for us. I'm aware of a couple, I'm just showing universities, I'm aware of a couple other research staff associations across the UK, two in Scotland in particular, the University of Edinburgh and Dundee have fairly good ties with between the research staff associations. If I'm missing one, I'm sorry, and undoubtedly, these are just universities, so they're undoubtedly institutes and other organizations that also have research staff associations. I'd like to know more about what's out there. I'd like to know what sort of networks exist for research staff. So please fill me in on what I'm missing later today, if you could. Internationally, I'd like to point out a couple things that also exist. Eurodoc and WAIS are both research staff organizations that cater to both postgrads and to research staff themselves, professional researchers. WAIS is the World Association of Young Scientists, and I'd actually have to confess I don't know very much about it because in talking to a colleague of mine at the National Postdoctoral Association in the US about putting together a forum for postdocs internationally so that we can talk about things like mobility for postdocs, research staff, I was looking around to see what other things existed and actually came across this. So the other two organizations that are fairly well established are the National Postdoctoral Association of the United States and the Canadian Association of Postdoctoral Scholars. And both of these organizations have had some contact with the National Research Staff Association of the UK and in part served as a model for how the National Research Staff Association was set up. Although I think that in 2006, when the UK's association was first set up, they were very mindful of the differences that exist and acted accordingly in setting up the UK association. There are a variety of networks that are available, and I think someone, I forget who actually, maybe Tanny mentioned earlier, ResearchGate, which should also be up here. I apologize if anyone's very involved in that network. But a lot of the online networks and the communities, online communities that exist generally take the form of like a blog plus comments or something like this, where someone posts a comment or an idea and the conversation ensues afterwards. Examples include Nature Network, of course, the research blog that we want to plug for Vitae that's recently been launched. Science Blogs is a collection of blogs that a number of scientists around the world have put together. And Lablet is sort of is not a blog properly. It's actually a venture that is more science and writing, but it tends to it comes from scientists in particular, from research staff. And it addresses issues in many cases that are affecting those researchers. And of course, as I said, ResearchGate. So again, if you know of other communities of researchers, then please let me know, because I'd like to learn more. And also to put in a plug for one of the sessions this afternoon, which is going to be addressing the online communities and resources that are available. So, as I said, what other communities exist, and which communities do you think are most effective in your experience at engaging researchers in their career development? In my own experience, the local communities tend to be very effective because they're very specific for the individuals that they're catering to or catering for. However, there's definitely a place for some of the larger scale research communities.